want to find the bad guy.
This ain't gonna be easy.
This week on At the Movies, some of the most anticipated movies of the year turned out to be really bad.
From box office stars to Oscar-winning actors to blockbuster hits.
Why am I laughing?
They all have one thing in common. They earned spots on our lists of the worst movies of 2008.
Say hi. Time now to take out the trash on this special show, The Worst Movies of 2008. I'm Ben Mankiewicz from Turner Classic Movies.
This is going to be a lot of fun, Ben. I'm Ben Lyons from E! Entertainment. I'm going to kick things off with my number 10 pick. It's Twilight, which was a huge box office success. Now, it's definitely not the worst movie of the year, but it's hands down the most disappointing one, and that's why it makes my list. I admit, I bought into the hype that swirled around the project for months on end before it was released. But I just wanted to be entertained, and I wasn't. The action was ridiculous, the special effects were just downright awful, and the actors played the entire glorified CW episode of a movie on one brooding note of teenage angst that made me anxious to get out of the theater.
I only said it'd be better if we weren't friends, not that I didn't want to be.
What does that mean?
It means if you were smart, you'd stay away from me.
Okay, well, let's say for argument's sake that I'm not smart.
At number 9, I have Speed Racer, another disappointing film. As a fan of the original cartoon series, I've been waiting a long time for Speed Racer to make its way to the big screen. I wish I was still waiting. Emile Hirsch and Christina Ricci, both fine young actors, were miscast in the roles of Speed and his girlfriend Trixie.
Speed Racer, what are you thinking?
That race was fixed. Someone's trying to crush everything in my life that matters to me.
And Matthew Fox was downright laughable as Racer X, thanks to some ridiculous costuming and dialogue. Anytime a chimp outshines Susan Sarandon in a movie, you know you've got problems.
When I watch you do some of the things you do, you just take my breath away. I'm so proud to be your mom.
Whoever spent money on my number 8 pick, Mad Money, should ask for a refund. This supposed comedy stars Diane Keaton, Katie Holmes, and Queen Latifah. They work in the Federal Reserve and figure out a way to scam their way to hundreds of thousands of dollars. It's a mess of a heist movie that wasn't funny or particularly clever.
Somebody is definitely peeing in her cup.
You know what? You gotta lighten up, or I'm gonna have to have you waxed.
When did you even start talking like that?
For every Something's Gotta Give, which I really enjoyed, it seems that these days, Diane Keaton is trapped in a film like Mad Money, or the equally horrendous Because I Said So. Here she is opposite Katie Holmes, who plays some sort of 21st century hippie love child. Really? This was awful, Ben.
Yeah, you know, it surprises me that you put Mad Money on the list because I forgot Mad Money existed.
You're better off for that.
I never remembered that this movie even took place. I want to talk about Twilight for a second. Twilight, terrible. The special effects, embarrassing. Sadly, that didn't seem to matter much at the box office.
Although it did fall off dramatically after its opening weekend.
Which means at least it's not getting the repeat viewers, which is a good sign. You mentioned, though, that it was the most disappointing movie of the year. That I'm going to disagree with you about sternly. It was terrible, but not the most disappointing.
I just wanted to have a good time, and ultimately I did it.
My list, Ben, begins with three words every film lover should fear. Pierce Brosnan singing.
When you're gone, how can I even try to go on?
Now, I like Pierce Brosnan. Great in the Thomas Crown Affair, brilliant in The Matador, but Mamma Mia was a brutal effort, a breezy Broadway musical that just dies on the big screen. Meryl Streep, Colin Firth, and Stellan Skarsgård are ill-suited for this musical based on music by ABBA, but each of those actors has one thing going for them. They weren't Pierce Brosnan.
Watch that scene. Dig in the dancing queen.
At number 9, I have The Love Guru, with Mike Myers painfully portraying Guru Pitka, a Deepak Chopra wannabe.
Are you all right?
Oh. I'd like to thank the Academy. Wow, these things are heavy.
Yeah. Put me down, jackass!
Okay.
Pitka, we learned, studied under Guru Tugginmaiputta, played by Sir Ben Kingsley.
Why do you want to join the Tugginmaiputta ashram?
So girls will like me. Then I will like myself.
Finding a cringe-inducing, humorless scene in The Love Guru is like shooting bad guys in a Vin Diesel movie. More on that later. Just one question. What was Ben Kingsley doing in this movie? Now, Ben, I know you loved my number 8 pick, Rachel Getting Married. In fact, a lot of critics liked it. I sort of hated it. In fact, I disliked it so much, I watched it a second time just to make sure I was right the first time. And I'm glad to say I was. In principle, sure, it's Jonathan Demme telling a moving story of a diverse musical family trying to throw a wedding for one daughter while adjusting to the return of another daughter, played by Anne Hathaway, from a long stint in drug rehab.
No, it's like you're not happy unless I'm in some kind of a desperate situation. You have no idea what to do with me unless I'm in crisis. But why am I the only one to save?
No, you are so much more evolved in your suffering.
I'm not, who is talking about
your
that?
Your suffering is not the most important thing to
who
everybody.
Who is saying it is?
The movie was like a wedding where you never stop looking at your watch for when it's okay to leave.
Let's get into Rachel Getting Married, because yeah. I love the film. Anne Hathaway, yeah. She's remarkable in this. And it's a family that is all about tolerance and acceptance and warmth. And here's this young girl who's doing everything in her power to push them away. I love the sort of cinema verite style that Jonathan Demme shoots this film with. He's a documentary film director, yeah. And he brings that aesthetic to this movie. That was great performances.
I like Anne Hathaway was good, I will grant that. I like warmth and tolerance. I don't like directionless, meandering, and aimless. And I didn't like one person in the movie. Not one character did I want to spend an hour with.
You completely missed it. Maybe watch it a third time?
Not a chance. Right. Coming up next, action stars Vin Diesel, Mark Wahlberg, and Brendan Fraser reach new lows.
I really hate money!
Plus, beware of dog. We continue our countdown of the worst movies of 2008.
Wow. It's a missile linked to my passport.
How can you stop it?
Only by death.
We're counting down the worst films of 2008. And at number 7 on my list, Vin Diesel in Babylon AD. He's Turok, a missionary who must safely get an orphan girl with special gifts from Mongolia to the U.S. And along the way, he must kick the crap out of a couple thousand evildoers.
How do you know my name?
We know a lot of things you don't know.
Yeah, like what?
Like you don't know what you're doing.
I'm doing my job.
Forget your job.
What?
At number 6, Mark Wahlberg in Max Payne, an adaptation of the popular video game. Max is a cop seeking revenge against his wife's killers. Apparently, the best way to do this is not smile for 100 minutes.
I could feel the dead down there, reaching up to welcome me as one of their own.
Max does have a professional assassin to help him, played by Mila Kunis. That's right, yeah, Mila Kunis, professional assassin. This is a pity because both Wahlberg and Kunis, as we know, are talented and have shown they're much better than this.
See if they know anything about a detective, Max Payne.
Max Payne.
What?
Stay away from Max Payne. You don't want to be near him when Judgment Day comes.
And at number 5, a movie that makes this list because of what it could have been. 21 is based on Ben Mezrich's wonderful book, Bringing Down the House, a thrilling tale of how 6 MIT students developed a sophisticated card counting scheme to win big money playing blackjack.
Let me make one thing clear to you. I am not your father. You are not my friend. This is a business. You were only as good to me as the money you make, and right now it's not worth a hell of a lot. You're going to give me back everything you lost.
No, I can't do that. That money was for Harvard. I have made you so much more than what I just lost.
In 21, the book's subtlety becomes an unimaginative stock caper film with an implausible storyline. It's another example of Hollywooding up a good story and leaving us with a terrible movie.
You know, Ben, I'm going to agree with you on 21. I think director Robert Lukacs was the wrong choice for this. His previous work includes Legally Blonde and How to Win a Date with Pat Hamilton, and he's ultimately too soft of a filmmaker for this gritty Vegas story.
Right, and that's why I put it on the list.
All right, Mank, at my number 7 pick, I've got one that you actually said to see it. It's Beverly Hills Chihuahua. Guard dogs sneaking across the U.S. border, fleeing from underground dogfights, and using piñatas as escape mechanisms. Isn't Mexican culture zany and hilarious?
Hold your tacos.
Yes.
Seriously, Beverly Hills Chihuahua takes the reward for the worst kids movie of the year. This year alone brought us Horton Hears a Who, Kung Fu Panda, WALL-E, Madagascar 2, and Bolt, so why would you waste your money on this really terrible movie?
If you ever need someone to lick inside your ears, I would be most honored.
Woof.
A mini Eddie Murphy inside of a big Eddie Murphy from outer space. That's the ridiculous premise of my number 6 pick, Meet Dave, directed by Brian Robbins. It actually makes Murphy's Norbit seem really hilarious.
I sort of have a rule that when I hit somebody with my car, I need to make them breakfast. That was a joke.
Aside from playing Donkey in the ridiculously popular Shrek series, Murphy hasn't really been funny on screen since Bowfinger.
Oh, you can't tell by the way I use my walk. I'm a woman, man. No time to talk. Hey, 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 stay alive.
At number five on my list, it's The Mummy, Tomb of the Dragon Emperor. This marks the third film in this ridiculous, over-the-top Indiana Jones knockoff of a franchise. Why these movies make money, I have no idea. The always boring Brendan Fraser reprises his role as Rick O'Connell. This time he's paired opposite Maria Bello, who's filling in for Rachel Weisz, who starred in the previous two films. Apparently, once Weisz won her Oscar, she no longer wanted to be chased by poorly CGI'd mummies around the world, and who can really blame her?
Here we go again.
Mank, this movie was so awful that it actually made me long for the days of Dwayne The Rock Johnson as the Scorpion King. You remember that one?
I do. That's saying something. Look, Beverly Hills Chihuahua. Yeah, I said see it. I think it was a harmless family movie, no more, no less. And a large reason for my recommendation was because smuggling dogs across the border were actual coyotes. That still makes me laugh. When we come back, one of the greatest franchises of all time makes my list. They should have quit while they were ahead.
Plus, an all-star female cast that just can't deliver.
She is fine.
She's Alex, not now.
Welcome. We're excited to have you.
Don't get too excited.
I'm not that excited.
And the carnage continues as we continue to count down the worst movies of 2008. Coming in at number four on my list is War, Inc. Here, John Cusack plays Brand Hauser, a disturbed and down-on-his-luck hitman in this political satire that, despite having an all-star cast, is utterly absurd. Cusack's cover comes in the form of planning the wedding of Yannicka Babyak, an outrageous Britney Spears-esque pop star played by that talented thespian, Hilary Duff. In this scene of supposed seduction, Duff stuffs a scorpion down her pants. I rest my case. Number three on the list is Synecdoche, New York. From the brilliant mind of writer and first-time director Charlie Kaufman, Philip Seymour Hoffman plays Caden, a struggling theater director who attempts to create a life-size replica of New York City inside a warehouse as part of a play that becomes his life's work. Confusing, contrived, and downright crazy at times, it's one of those movies where if 10 people were to see it, 8 would absolutely hate it, 1 would be indifferent, and 1, for God knows why, would think it's brilliant. I am one of those 8. I just hated it.
I disappointed you somehow?
Everyone is disappointing. The more you know someone.
I don't know what I'm doing.
Knowing that you don't know is the most essential step to knowing, you know?
The second worst movie of the year is The Women. It's the story of a group of upper-class women who shop all day, hate the men in their lives, and attend glitzy beauty salons and high-end fashion runway shows. No, I said it's The Women, not Sex and the City. I never once believed that Meg Ryan, Annette Bening, Jada Pinkett Smith, and Deborah Messing would be friends. Not one time.
Okay. All right, I appreciate all of you trying to help. I really do, but please don't dissect and analyze every square inch of this right now. I can't take it. Just be there for me, silently.
Important to note that not all women are shoe snobs obsessed with handbags. This movie is demeaning to women and insulting to fans of good movies.
At number four on my list, a movie about three kids who couldn't spell MIT. Drake Bell headlines College, about three high school seniors cast shamelessly to look like the super bad crew who take a trip to the U for the weekend to see what college is all about. Well, it turns out it's all about cruelty, shallowness, and homophobia. I started counting the gay jokes, but then my pen ran out of ink.
They got pledges to do this?
Oh, what's your step, pre-frost? This ain't high school!
The movie is a rarity, completely humorless and utterly offensive. Next up, my number three pick, Filth and Wisdom. Now, putting Madonna's directorial debut on this list seems too easy. Gypsy punk rock singer Eugene Hutz plays AK, one of three London flatmates. He's trying to finance his music career as a dominatrix, but he's a tame dominatrix. In fact, that reminds me, this is a poorly titled film. It's not filthy, and it's certainly not wise. It's just bad.
If you spend your whole life as a saint, eventually you will crave the opposite.
You're pathetic. Time is up.
Thank you.
My number two film was horrible no matter what your vantage point. So clever. Vantage Point had a great cast, Dennis Quaid, Forrest Whitaker, William Hurt, among others, and a great premise, an attempted presidential assassination from a bunch of different perspectives. But it was just repetitive, jumpy, confusing, repetitive, and also repetitive.
Christ has saved me alive.
Stop. Rewind that.
Oh, my God.
What did he see?
In the end, an unsophisticated gimmick that, despite like 12 tries, failed to answer this question. Who are the people who did it and why? Just terrible, yet it cleared over $150 million worldwide.
Well, coming up next, we each make our picks for the absolute, hands-down, worst movie of 2008.
All right, we've been scraping the bottom of the barrel to find the worst movies of the year, and at the bottom of my list, a movie that earns the number one spot because it ranks as the most disappointing movie in years.
This ain't gonna be easy.
Not as easy as it used to be.
How could Steven Spielberg, George Lucas, and Harrison Ford wait 20 years for the right script to make Indy 4 and end up with this? Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull is predictable, unimaginative, derivative of its predecessors, not celebratory. And I can't believe I'm saying this, it's incomprehensible.
Legend says that a crystal skull was stolen from a mythical lost city in the Amazon, supposedly built out of solid gold, guarded by the living dead. Whoever returns the skull to the city temple will be given control over its power.
Guys, we know you're brilliant, so please make a fifth installment to get this bad taste from my mouth.
At number one on my list, Paris Hilton stars in the cult, rock, horror, whatever it is movie, Repo, the Genetic Opera. The movie takes place in the year 2056, and an epidemic of organ failures has the entire world seeking transplants from a company called Genco, but for a price. Fail to make your payment, and the mighty Repo Man comes to repossess your body parts. Ugh. Honestly, I'd rather have my own spleen ripped out of my body than to be subjected to this laughable disgrace of a movie again.
And Amber Sweet is addicted to the knife.
Addicted to the knife?
Addicted to the knife.
And addicted to the knife, she needs a little help with the agony.
As for good old Paris Hilton, what can I say? Her 10 or so minutes on screen, including one moment on stage at the opera when her face literally falls off, are forgettable at best. The best part of the movie was the credits, which meant I got to go home and pretend the whole thing never happened. Just absolutely hated this.
Yeah, there was really nothing redeeming about this movie. Even Sarah Brightman, who's been on Broadway doing real musicals, she sounded the best of all the singers, but really nobody stood out. Paul Sorvino, who has an opera background, when everybody turned to the camera and started to sing, it was cringe-inducing, very painful from start to finish, and unbelievably bloody
and
violent.
It's the same director as Saw 2, 3, and 4, and I'm all for genre movies, but I just don't have the stomach for something as repulsive as this.
Or a spleen.
We'll be back to recap our complete lists of the worst films of 2008 right after this.
Closed captioning for At the Movies is sponsored by
Naturals from Purina Cat Chow. With whole grains, real chicken and salmon, and the goodness of leafy greens. You live well, you eat right. Help your cat do the same. Naturals from Purina Cat Chow.
Hotel provided by Park Hyatt Chicago. Chicago's award-winning hotel and luxury dining experience. Located in the heart of Chicago's Magnificent Mile on Water Tower Square.
All right, we're going to relive the nightmare one last time. Here's a full recap of our list of the worst films of 2008. For me, number 10 is Twilight. Number 9 is Speed Racer. At number 8, it's Mad Money. Number 7, Beverly Hills Chihuahua. At number 6, Meet Dave. Number 5, The Mummy, Tomb of the Dragon Emperor. Number 4, War Inc. Number 3, Synecdoche, New York. Number 2, The Women. And at number 1, it's Repo, the Genetic Opera.
All right, here's my list. At number 10, the musical Mamma Mia. Number 9, Mike Myers, the Love Guru. Number 8, Rachel Getting Married. Number 7, Babylon A.D. Number 6, Max Payne. At the number five spot, 21. Coming in fourth, College. Number three, Madonna's Filth and Wisdom. Number two, Vantage Point. And number one, the most disappointing movie in years, Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull.
To revisit our picks for the worst movies of the year, go to atthemovies.tv.com.
And next week, we'll be back with reviews of new films. And until then, as always, we'll be at the movies.
The rhinovirus, a leading cause of the common cold. Why just cover up the symptoms of your cold when you can get over your cold faster with Zicam?
I want my coffee to taste like this, sweet and low. You know, you can't beat pig, pal.
But you probably know that.
My bliss? Blistex Complete Moisture. A rush of moisture lips can feel. And it feels great. Discover bliss. Discover Blistex.
Choose PlumSmart. It's clinically proven to help regulate your digestion with a unique blend of prebiotic fiber, magnesium, and potassium. PlumSmart and PlumSmart Lite from SunSweet.